I tried for years, right, to understand what it meant to be gay, a preacher, Black, and still be in church. I tried for years, and it's something I buried for years.
What's up, everybody? This is Lisa Fields, the founder and president of the Jude 3 Project, and I'm so excited because we have season 2 of Why Don't Go. Now, if you've been tracking with us for any amount of time, you know that we have a very popular series that we started last year called Why Don't Go. And the purpose of Why Don't Go is to sit down with young adults to discuss why they left the church. In the first part, we just love to listen to them. I feel like listening is an act of love, and we can't be good apologists if we're not good listeners. So the first part of this series, I'll just be listening to them for 4 episodes. And then we'll have Q&A where they'll get to ask me and my co-host Rasul Berry some hard-hitting questions about church and the faith. Season 2 is located in the beautiful city of Washington, D.C. I know you're going to enjoy the conversation we have with young professionals about why they no longer go to church. I hope you really enjoyed the first episode. Now, here's episode 2.
Do y'all feel like your life is better now that you've left church? Why or why not?
Yeah. I would say so. I'm all about iteration. I'm all about transformation. And, you know, a couple of them hit on it. Church was very ritualistic. It just became a thing on my calendar. I mean, like, literally, it was on my calendar. And I'm just like, I have to go to church because that's what I have for the next, 6 hours.
No, we're talking about,
oh yeah, we didn't go to church until the sunset. You know, we're there in the morning. We got Sabbath school. After Sabbath school, it's a little lunch. And then you have midday service. And then you always had a guest preacher because, you know, the sun didn't, especially when it was long days, right? Like the sun's not set, you're still in church.
If you could give the man 8 hours on that job,
you can give the Lord 8 hours. That was what was said, right? So we were in church for a long time. So it just became something to do. And I feel like my life is more rewarding now because I'm not just doing something, I'm living something. And it's the something I always felt like I was built and put on this earth to do. It's funny, Dennis, you talked about sort of like grappling with church, real world expectations. It's this sermon that was preached, Work the Middle. Right? Bishop Moles preached, Work the Middle. You have the beginning, you have the end. We know the end result. He was like, but it's our job to work the middle. And I feel like church has skipped over that, right, a lot. And so Rob Enlow has a fantastic book, 7 Mountain Prophecies, where he talks about the mountains of the kingdom and how we need people in place in each of these different mountains in order for the kingdom to encapsulate the earth, for humanity to actually improve, be better, be our full selves. And I took that to heart when I read that book because it talked about the mountain of music. It talked about the mountain of education. It talked about what I do, the mountain of government, and how we have been placed on here strategically for a certain reason. And I don't feel like that is every Saturday or Sunday walking into a building. I'm happier. I have more friends. My job is stressful but fulfilling, right? Like, stress does not dissolve because you're out of church, but it's more fulfilling. I am busy, so that's part of it. I make more money than I've ever made before. It's not just about the money, but you know, it's a sign of success. I have friendships, meaningful friendships that are non-judgmental, but supportive and harsh when needed. So like actual friends, right? I would say my life has improved because I am not stuck into 4 walls, but really thinking about how can my outreach be more inclusive than my inreach.
I would have to agree. There's always going to be a part of me, because it was so much of my life, that longs for or yearns for the every Sunday, you know, that ritual part of getting up, getting dressed and going to church. because it's what we did. It's what you do. It's what you were brought, you're raised to, you know, most people that I know, at least, this is how you were raised. This is what we do. You go to Bible study, you go to Sunday school, you go to Sabbath school, you do, like, these are the things. But I find myself now more fulfilled, and I understand ministry in a different way. And I understand, you know, to Daniel's point, one of the things that I was taught long ago was that same thing. We are put in positions for a reason, and that's ministry as well. You know, we focused a lot of our time, I know at least for me when I was younger, on, you know, ministry was the elder, the evangelist, the person in the pulpit, the deacons, those that you saw in the front. But as God blesses you financially and prospers you on your professionally, those are ways that you can also minister. And those are ways that you can also shine God's light in this world. And it's not necessarily in the four walls of the church. If you look at even what Jesus did, it wasn't always in the church. That's not where he went. And so I find that I'm more fulfilled in being able to make a difference and have a higher impact now in the community. And, you know, it's still, there's still a God center, but it's just not, I'm not wearing the big hats and, you know, the fluffy suits and all the stuff and, you know, that I used to wear, you know, being a little cheap church lady. So that's, you know, but the fulfillment is still there. The desire to serve is still there. And I think the stress of the rules and the all of that is gone. And that's allowed for freedom of thought and for us to learn and grow. As you were saying, how do we start to really build an intersection between what's happening in church and the world? And then you can really make even a greater impact. So I think, you know, it's been freeing to kind of leave that paradigm alone for a while and just kind of think about how we can really grow as a person.
Triana?
So for me, the answer is yes. It's a lot less stressful without all of the rules and the expectations even, because I was a Sunday school teacher. I was in the choir. I did everything. I was in Sunday school. I was, you know, involved. I took trips. I was everywhere. But my life is still better outside of the church. And as I was saying, you know, I almost feel bad that the answer is yes, because of how long I was in church and how I used to go every Sunday. I still wake up on Sundays and I'm like, dang, I should probably go to church, even though I really don't want to. It's just that I've been doing it for so long that I'm like, well, I guess I should do it. But yes, my life is a lot less stressful, and I would say that it's better without church.
Jasmine?
I'll say it's different. I had the privilege of being in a more progressive church. So all I really wanted was the choice to not go, or, you know, go. So once that was lifted and I had the choice to not go, I was also granted the choice of my beliefs and choosing what I wanted. It's been a different journey now. So I don't physically go to a church, but in the Black community, church is a part of your culture. So even if you're not at a physical church, you still have to deal with the things you went through at church. For example, being judged for certain things, having certain opinions, and you don't say that type of thing. And now that I'm getting older, oh, I do say that. But I also censor myself, and, like, you know, if people give me a vibe of their beliefs are very churchy, I'm usually censor myself or probably not engage. Whereas if I meet somebody that's a little similar to myself in terms of questioning things, or they're a little bit open, then I feel more comfortable to talk. So I won't necessarily say it was the best thing that's ever happened, but it definitely changed things, changed the trajectory in terms of my faith. So I was granted freedom. So I was more freedom, let's say.
Dennis?
Well, for me, I don't know whether it's completely certainly yes, but the benefit that I've gotten from leaving the church emotionally and sometimes physically is having the freedom to wrestle with my doubts. I felt before leaving the church, I had a lot of doubts, but I was not confident enough to, like, express them in a church setting. And it's only after I distanced myself away from the church that I had the freedom and liberty to use my mind and actually wrestle with some of these deep questions. So that is very liberating. But at the same time, it's scary when you wrestle with like really heavy topics and you don't necessarily have an answer. So that part is, I wouldn't say it's the best part, but at the end of the day, having the freedom to exercise a God-given ability is definitely the best part.
That's great that you expressed that, because that leads me to my next question. I know a lot of people struggle in church with it being a safe place to express doubt. Do you think your church was a safe space where you could question God, question what was happening? And if not, what were some questions that you felt like the church wasn't ready to talk about or answer?
I would say the church I spent most of my time in, the church where I was ordained, it was a place to ask questions about life that we were experiencing, but it was not a place to doubt the intentions of God. Right? And it was said just like that. You don't doubt God. So it was a mix, right? Like I could ask, I'm dealing with this issue and I don't know how to overcome it. And it, sometimes it's to just pray about it. Like, just pray about it, everything's gonna be okay. Sometimes it's to, you know, go to the altar and throw up and vomit for an hour, right, after the mothers lay hands on you.
You know,
right, like, call the intercessors on, you know, like, you know, sometimes it's that moment. But it was never a place to doubt the will of the Lord. And I think that's what I had the most difficulty with, because now I feel comfortable saying it, but I tried for years, right, to understand what it meant to be gay, a preacher, Black, and still be in church. I tried for years, and it's something I buried for years. And it wasn't okay, right? It's still not okay. So I had to, I've always tried to grapple with the question, why do we shun people from the LGBT community, particularly in the Pentecostal church, when the denomination was built off the influence of LGBTQ interactions, right? Like, it was the history of the LGBTQ community in church is so profound, particularly in the Pentecostal movement, that we're not even welcome. And it's sort of when you bring that reality to the face of people, it's now you just don't understand, you know, it's past your understanding. You have to pray about it. You know, you have to seek the Lord, fast for 40 days. But there was never an answer. And it's still the biggest question I have to this day about church. But overall, it's, you know, I would say it was a place of expressing, but it wasn't a place of disagreement. Could not disagree. Right? Ask your question. But what I tell you is the law, and you have to follow that law. So go through your moments, right? Like, go through your moments, get yourself together. But at the end of it, what I tell you is what the Lord said, because I am His prophet. The Lord speaks to me, right? Like, the Lord speaks to me. And so that was, I would say that's the biggest. You certainly can question, but you can't disagree.
Thank you for sharing that. Tish?
I think, in some instances, I think even to question could be problematic, because the more you grow, the more you explore and research. Like, I'm the type of person when, you know, I was 20, was researching the history of the Bible. Like, I want to know who wrote, not, you know, who wrote it in the sense of Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, but who, you know, why are we following the King James Version? You know, why is this the penultimate version? You know, if you're in the Catholic Church, there are other books in their Bible. What happened? And when you start asking questions about the foundation of the church itself and religious culture, then you're doing too much. You're doing too much. Why are you at, you know, it's like, you know, back to some of the things that you were saying about how, you know, culture and race intersect with Christianity. You're doing too much. That's not, you know, you're supposed to be, you know, have faith in God and do what I say and go home. You know, and so that was always problematic for me, because you couldn't ask questions. Or if you asked, a question, sometimes the answers were just not helpful. You know, when I was struggling in my marriage, you know, one of the pastor's wives told me it was my fault because I'm not being subservient enough. You know, I'm supposed to yield to him and I'm supposed to do this. Well, what if I don't want to? You know, and you, this is your answer? Like, so, well, this is what I do for Bishop. And it, but what about me? And how am I supposed to learn? And so these are the things that, you know, when you start asking real life questions, you know, I think I might be depressed. And they say the blood of Jesus. No, I might need to see a counselor. You know, I think I might, you know, have a, you know, I have a college friend who had a eating disorder. They put her in a prayer line. You know, so it's when you start to ask about real life things, sometimes the answer didn't match where you were, or if you even got an answer. You know, they're just going to tell you to pray, or they're going to gloss over it and give you a couple of scriptures to read, and then that's, you know, the end of it. And if you're lucky, you're going to get a leader that's going to take the time to maybe point you in the right direction. Maybe I can't help you, but, you know, have you thought about talking to someone? Or maybe we need to do this, you know, but depending on what type of church you're in, that could be few and far between, you know, and I think that goes back to denominations and all of that. Some you'll find it, and others finding the resources, you know, you start asking questions that should trigger, you know, this is a red flag, or maybe there's something else, or they're seeking help, they need help. Sometimes you don't get it, you get told to pray.
Mm-hmm.
So, no, my church, the church that I grew up in, not the church plant, I feel like the church plant, they answered my questions more than the church I was in for my whole childhood. But there, no, we could not ask any questions. I am in graduate school and I'm studying mental health. So when I brought that up to the church, it was a lot of, ain't nothing wrong with them kids. They don't need this. They don't need to go see it. They need to pray. They need to put them down on the altar. And so if this is my passion, I want to study mental health, but then I have you saying that I need to pray for my clients, I'm like, this doesn't work. But a lot of the times, those were the questions that I asked, and I never got an answer, or it was pray for them. So no, we couldn't ask questions.
Can you ask me that question again?
What were you allowed to question in church, and what were the questions that weren't answered for you?
So I always had questions, but there would be times when things were said that I wouldn't agree with it. And it was just like, I don't agree with it, but I don't feel like arguing with people about it. And that's where that would be the issue I'd have. For example, like with pro-choice and just like having all these babies and like, you know, you have to be submissive to your husband. Like, and here I am just like, what? That doesn't make sense to me. And because it was more of like that's the word of the Bible and God says, and this is, I'd just be like, all right. It just made me not even want to ask questions or ask different people questions or come to my own answer. What was another one that, like, and even how, like, they treat homosexuality, it was just like, if we're supposed to love everybody, I know they're not, or I know it's considered a sin, but it's just like, so? Like, it just became a lot of alienation and just, like, being shady or petty, and I just, it just didn't sit right. And just a lot of the questions I had became, like, made me question in terms of who I am, what are my beliefs, and just having to formulate that on my own just seemed like a better option than staying and asking more questions, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing. Dennis?
For me, it's a combination of yes and no. I think the churches that I've visited and were a part of growing up, they were open to questions that they had answers to. And you could read a church manual, and there's already a list of questions and answers. There's common questions asked across different churches. What happens when people die, and what do you believe about this and that? But once you start questioning things outside of the realm of like what the church generally thinks about, I didn't necessarily find a safe space to engage in like meaningful debate or dialogue. And so, yes, you could doubt and question things they already have answers to, but things that there's certain things that were definitely off top, like you're not supposed to even talk about these things. And some of the specifics were living in a very liberal area like DC, you have friends from all walks of life. And so I started to grapple within myself the influence that I got from the church in terms of relating with people that have a different sexual orientation than I do. But when the church would influence you to behave a certain way, but then I'm prompted to preserve a friendship or like preserve a human dignity, like I prefer to maintain a relationship versus follow a church's influence and like treat them as an outcast. And so I would want to grapple with those things in a church setting, but they were not equipped to talk about these things. And so those are kind of the things that made me continue to distance myself away from, like, if this is a church that is loving, but at the same time chooses who to be loving with, yeah, that's kind of where I'm at.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you for sharing. Thank you all for sharing. Y'all, that, because I know for me, when I was doubting in undergrad, that's a very sensitive space to be in. And sometimes you don't want to share for what people will say because you're so vulnerable in that space. So I appreciate y'all all for sharing that, because I think it's helpful and instructive for those who are listening.
Thank you all for listening with me. I hope you learned something just like I learned something. Stay tuned for the next episode.
I spent my whole life in the church and kind of feel like, I don't want to say I have nothing to show for it, but I don't even have the knowledge to argue with somebody about it. So